The basic idea of this is to chat for about half an hour. It's very informal, so feel free to take it wherever you want. If you want to talk about high school or whatever, it's okay. It's not like, you know, it's not so much of an XYZ interview. That's not the idea. Anyway, so you guys started this adventure, well, at Sundance, started showing the movie for the first time, yes?
Yeah, the first screening of more than five people in the audience was at Sundance.
So what was it like to give birth to your first child with people looking at you at Sundance?
Well, luckily it was happened right away when we got there. It was one of the first screenings. And so that took some of the suspense out of it. And just sort of being there the first time was overwhelming. I didn't get too nervous about it, although I did clutch my husband's arm through the whole thing. And so to hear the first laughter, the first response from the audience, that was like the baby came out, really. And then I just turned to my producer and I was like, it's funny, I told you it was funny. And it's not that funny.
It's not really a comedy.
Not so much with it. But there are moments that it was really important to have light moments, because without them, you know, it's got some heavy subject matter, but you need the audience to be able to just catch their breath, you know, and life does kind of go up and down like that. So I was just relieved.
And you've done the Sundance circuit before with Chris Ayres movies?
Yeah.
So were you just an old hat at it? Was it just, you know, like, no big deal?
I was, but I never got the kind of treatment we did with Frozen River, because we were very indie, very low budget, and you know, we'd get in a native forum, and we'd get in a few parties and stuff, but never on this level.
You couldn't get into parties?
No, I got into parties.
She gets into parties. She gets into where she wants.
But the network of people I was with didn't have all these parties we were set to go to.
She must have been exhausted by the fun.
Oh, I'm always exhausted by the fun at Sundance.
And you're now a vet. You're kind of like become the queen of the indies again and again. Uh-huh. Your career is kind of recycled a few times.
That's
you kind of started
way,
as a queer as a queen of the indies, and then you kind of went to television for a little bit, and then with 21 Grams you've become, you know, the go-to person for a lot of these pictures. So is it different going back again, or is it?
No, it's not. I mean, my career is a sort of a patchwork quilt, and you know, the big breaks, I've had a lot of them. They never seem to have projected me to the moon.
Do you want to be projected to the moon? It seems like that's not
I love working. I really love working. And yeah, a few years ago it sort of dawned on me that people like make a lot of money doing what I do. So that might be an interesting thing to foray into at some point. It's not a career I've picked and chosen. It's not been plotted in the least. It's sort of who would have me. And I love the indie film. There's, you know, if I was picking and choosing, what I would pick and choose is great stories with really good character in them of a moderate size, so we could pay the crew a little bit more than what we paid.
Right.
I don't need to be terribly more comfortable than we were, but I think that paying people a, you know, decent wage is an important thing, especially when you ask of a crew what we were asking of them.
Yeah, this is a tough shoot.
Yeah, but there's something about, I always talk about, you know, the difference between theater and film is, you know, theater is something that's very well rehearsed. And film is all about capturing something, right? So when you have just 24 days to capture it, it's kind of a sweet way to make a movie, you know? Maybe 5 weeks instead of 3 weeks, you know? But there's somewhere in there, because then once you get over a certain mark with budgeting, the waste is just, that's kind of appalling to be a part of. You know, because it doesn't all show up on the screen. And
Can I interrupt and just say,
yeah,
just in terms of shooting her to the moon, she would never think, no, she doesn't think like that at all. But when I saw her in 21 Grams, you know, there are actresses that you look at and you think, I don't know if I'd put them in charge. I don't know if they can carry a feature. But when I saw her in 21 Grams, and if you look at her roles, I think you can see that she could carry a feature, and that was critically important. So if I can help, you know, rocket her to a place where she could do that again, that would be a good thing. And I think that she would never think that way, but I certainly was thinking that way.
So, well, I mean, it's interesting that you thought that way, because it's a somewhat analytical process for a first-time filmmaker. I mean, you think of you leading purely with a heart, but what is it that dragged you into this endeavor? What was the inspiration to get
for the movie, for the story?
For the story in particular, but in general, just wanting to be a filmmaker and, you know, tell your own tell a story that you wrote.
Well, that came about because my mom loved art house movies, and so from the time I was 6 or 7 years old, we went to art house double features, you know, just all the time. Wherever we lived, it was the one thing that we just, and she loved to do, and she took me along. I saw way too much too soon, and it was the 70s, and it was all good, and
what was the movie you were least supposed to see?
I don't think Seven Beauties is really appropriate.
For the 8 year old.
Yeah, but whatever. And so that's where I grew to love those, that private world, that dark and private world that you get when you go to the movies. I learned that from my mom. And so, you know, film school and all that stuff came later, but really the essential, my love of movies came from just going to movies and having nobody tell me how to interpret them, just seeing them. They either affect you or they don't.
And so how did this story come to you? What was the...
Well, I knew that there was smuggling at the border of New York State and Canada because my husband's from a small town up there. So everyone kind of knows there's a smuggling culture going back all the way to Prohibition. But then I learned that women were involved in it often, and that and after 9/11, that illegal immigrants were the big commodity. And that to me was really interesting because we'd been in New York in 9/11, and this is, you know, 300 miles due north of the city. So I was interested in this sort of central image of these two women from two different cultures, one Mohawk Indian, one white, stuck in a car together, driving back and forth across the frozen St. Lawrence River. That was sort of this active kind of adventure image for me that kind of drove me to look at why a woman would do that, what circumstances would lead up to that. So then sort of working back to discover the motivations.
And what inspired you to go, I have the cojones to go make a movie, you know, to actually get this done and fight my way through it and be the director and not just sell the script off to somebody or do anything like that?
It never crossed my mind to sell the script off to anyone. I don't know. My mom said you can do whatever you want. And I believed her. and really, I mean, I never even considered doing that. It was hard. I won't say it wasn't a journey, but again, you know, there's 100 ways to skin a cat. You know, you just, this doesn't work, so you try this, you know, and you just sort of go forward. And as long as the image and the sort of the truth of that script was in my heart, it wasn't that hard to go forward. I mean, it was hard sometimes because it was a lot of rejection. You know, everyone said, you don't have anybody super duper famous, you know, this isn't really saleable, what border are you talking about? What are you talking about? And who are you anyway? So there was a lot of no, but you know, you figure out another way around it.
So were you committed to your cast pretty much before you went out to fund?
Oh yeah.
Including your both?
We had done a short originally. When Courtney approached me, meeting me after the 21 Gram screening, she asked if I would do her short. And I read this fabulous little script that my character was carrying, and there was this co-star. The parts were the blonde and the Mohawk. They had no names. A lot of hanging questions in it. But a beautiful little short about these two women stuck in this car together. And so we shot that in 6 days or something, where this actually takes place up in northern New York, Messina, New York, where the St. Lawrence divides Canada and New York. And then for about 3 years, I would call Courtney every 6 or 7 months because it's not that many lead scripts that have crossed my desk. And not that many people, nobody except for Courtney, that has believed this thing, that I could carry it. And it was clear she did, but it wasn't clear if she was going to actually go forward and make the film. You know, she had a little daughter, and you know, that is quite a distracting thing, and I think the rejection and one thing and another, and I would call her up and say, so we're making this movie? And she, you know, start back up again with it and, mm-hmm. and looking for the money and kept with it.
I was,
and it
was looking three, the whole time. I didn't tell you three, every part of it.
You know, I did. I know. There's
bad
so,
news
so much
all the time.
All the
so
bad
I just
news.
Act like, oh yeah, I should definitely get back to that.
Was there a feature length script when you did the short, or was that?
No, the short kind of gave me the confidence to go back and sit down and write that, write it as a feature, because the mm-hmm. short got into New York Film Festival, which was a great and wonderful moment in my life. But that little vote of confidence from them mm-hmm. Showed me that this idea, you know, I was onto something. So then I went back and sat down and said, okay, now what's the whole story here? And just started all over again.
And how did you get into the middle of all this?
Well, I was actually at Sundance when Courtney called me. I was promoting Edge of America. Mm-hmm. And
a very underseen movie, a really great movie that just didn't quite get, never got the distribution that it deserved. It was
Well, it was with Showtime, so we had a couple of things there. But Courtney had looked me up on the internet. She was looking for Native actresses, and she went to the site Native Celebs and looked through a bunch of pictures and found me and liked me and looked at my content and my little page there. So she called me up and we talked for an hour. And then she asked me if I'd like to be a part of it.
I'm just amazed there's a website called NativeCelebs.com. Yeah.
there's several. And it's from people in the Netherlands and Europe who just really love the Native American culture.
So she called up and you just said, okay.
Well, we talked for an hour and I asked her tons of questions and but I was just more than happy to do something different, something new. Mm-hmm. Get out of the Chris Sayre little ring there. So
it's a little limiting.
It's very limiting, and it's not something I completely want for my whole career.
Yeah. It's a challenge to get out of that in general, I think. I mean, I think Melissa in some ways is in the same place in a different way, but it's a very
I think it's more so challenging for me in particular in certain ways, because like, they don't think I could play normal roles.
Right.
Like, I can't play the neighbor, the nice neighbor, or I can't play the lawyer, mm-hmm. or I can't play, you know, the, you know, just normal roles. I'm always playing the young alcoholic or the domestically abused res girl, or, you know, there's only so much.
But, yeah, I mean, the industry does love to do that, of sort of get you pigeonholed. I'll never forget, after I had played Benicio del Toro's wife in 21 Grams, I got out of the blue, dropped in my lap, an offer to do, I think it was a CSI episode, mm-hmm. in which the story hinged on a mixed race couple, white chick married to a Spanish guy. Oh, Melissa can do that. And I'm sure that's why it dropped in my lap, because they do, once they see you do one thing, they figure, oh, that's what she does.
Yeah. Well, that's, you're going to be stuck doing these movies forever now.
Oh, darn.
Two Women in a Car. Thelma and Louise, too. And, so doing the short, is that what was the experience of doing the short like versus doing the feature, ultimately? Was it, did she change a lot at all as a director between the two experiences, or?
Directing a feature is a much mightier task than directing a short. It really is. The ability to, it's why I would never step into the director's shoes. It's a responsibility I would not care to take on my shoulders. You've got to think of every man on the ship. And Courtney is, she had never done it before. There was a learning curve, but good God, she learned, and in a flat second learned. And on we went, and it was really remarkable, and she did that thing that's really always delightful in a director, that they don't need to know everything. You know, they need to know their film, but there's a shooter there to help them know the lights and the angles. There's a continuity person to help them know the, you know, and she knew how to use the help that was there with her.
Is she a handholder, or is she a... We always get into this conversation
with
actors about...
She's a great director in that way, because she'll come at you whatever you need. She was very different. The way she was with Misty and the way she was with me. We have very different needs as actors, very different techniques. It's technique, I think, but she had very different ways she dealt with us.
Yes?
Mm-hmm. That's correct. Mm-hmm. Well, no, you know, I think that my whole goal was, I heard Seiji Ozawa talking about when he first started conducting, and that he was like really arrogant, he was bossing everybody around, and like, I guess the orchestra got up and left. And that what he learned was that you have to invite people. Mm-hmm. Everyone there needs to be invited by you, and your job is to invite them. And so I just took that to heart and said, okay, these people have come up here to help me, and I have to invite them to share their talent. And that goes for the grips, that goes right up the ladder to everybody. And so to ask them, kind of with humility, to come and be a part of this and to bring what they have. And whatever they need, I fill in. You know, whatever they need from me. So, you know, Melissa and Misty couldn't be more different as actresses, mm-hmm. but both so talented. And the result is obvious, but they work in entirely different ways.
Did you guys do a lot of rehearsal or any rehearsal?
No, we did no rehearsal. Let me be clear. We had 9 days of pre-production. The money mm-hmm. arrived just in time for the ice, mm-hmm. and so we had to just go or miss the winter.
Right.
And so that's what we did, and we just...
Was that your financing deadline? Was that you were saying, you know, we need the money by this date or we're not going to have ice?
We were literally waiting for it to hit the account. We were just waiting for it to actually hit the account. And what we did was we just went up there, but you have to remember, we'd done the short film, so these two had it in their mind. They had a blueprint. Mm. They had essentially a rehearsal at that point, and then 3 years to let that thing grow. And whatever the relationship was, hadn't really fully been explored. And so everybody arrived, I think, ready to do that. So that was a big help.
Was shooting the ice as difficult as it looked, or was that the easy part?
It was important to make it safe. And we did, you know, we did make sure that it was going to hold us. You know, it had to be 18 to 22 inches thick, and we mm-hmm. had a guy come out, and he would auger and measure and make sure it was safe. But we didn't have a stunt person, and, you know, we didn't, Melissa did all of her own driving, and I don't know, she seemed game, and we just got out there and did it, you know. It's just a big flat surface. Once mm-hmm. you know it's going to hold you,
It's a little bit like driving in the snow.
Yeah.
It's not.
But you're also shooting a lot of darkness, a lot of night.
It was the night and I think the cold that was really the biggest obstacle. And, you know, for the most part, the weather cooperated. Because on the one hand, we needed ice, so we needed cold. On the other hand, you know, if it's too cold, people start to lose their energy.
When the camera freezes up.
But
your
some
jaw
of our.
Freezes up.
Exactly.
Can't talk.
I kept quite comfortable through the cold. That I really came to it sort of, you know, some time growing up in Vermont and some time living with a ski teacher.
Mm-hmm.
I came, you know, very prepared for what the weather was. I had read the script. so it was not uncomfortable for me. We held ourselves in the car a lot. There were mm-hmm. no trailers or anything like that, but the car was really a better place to sort of just hang while they set up shots. But the crew and Courtney were out there suffering without a doubt.
For 24 days. Did you know what 24 days meant when you agreed to do this in 24 days? I mean, did it change?
We just did exactly what we needed to do for the schedule, you know, excluding massive mistakes, you know,
right.
sort of, and what we could afford.
Did it end up being a huge challenge? Did it end up being difficult to make your days, or
it
you just kind of move along?
It was so down to the bone. We had to everybody had to focus. There was no room for a massive mistake, you know,
mm-hmm.
and everyone knew it. And my first Alfonso was so amazing. And he scheduled it where it was a little bit humane,
mm-hmm.
but we got it all done. And I credit him with that. He just did a beautiful job. And so, you know, it was challenging, but in a way it was healthy because we just didn't have room for ego. We had no room for huge mistakes or pondering things. It was like, the story's ready to go, the actors are ready to go, go.
And it was delightful as we went along, too, because we all stayed in the same little motel there
mm-hmm.
in Plattsburgh. And we'd get back to the hotel at night, and every single day, without exception, Courtney would look at me down the hall and say, "We got it." Whatever it was that we had to get that day.
Mm-hmm.
And if she could get it in one take, she'd get it in one take. And if she needed to go 10, she'd go 10 until she got what she needed. either with the acting quality or the shooting quality or whatever those things were that she was looking for. She's a very, very canny director. And you used everything you shot, right?
Yes, we used everything we shot. That's correct.
There's not a four-hour version of Frozen River out there just waiting to happen?
Just ask Kate Williams, the editor. She's like, is there any more? And I'm like,
nope. No.
So you had, in this way, in some ways, this would seem to be like a kind of an opportunity to grow and expand for all three of you. But the fact that it's a movie about women, made by a woman, was that a significant part of it for you? Was that special in and of itself, or is it just another movie?
Every experience filmmaking has its different qualities, and of course, your captain sort of sets the tone for the whole dang thing, mm-hmm. even more than the piece itself. Who the director is what sets the tone, and it was delightful. I don't know that it has that much to do with gender. I mean, but it was lovely. Our shooter was a female as well, and there was a ease of communication, perhaps mm-hmm. the way that women communicate in so many ways was perhaps helpful to it. But.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there's a different way women communicate. About stuff like Reed and I, the DP, would get out there and we'd have one of these conversations like, I think we should do it over there. Or what do you want to do? Well, okay, oh, I'll do that. No, okay, do you, was that good for you? And it would go back and forth, and Alfonso would just be like, kind of like, but we'd come to it in probably the same amount of time as a guy mm-hmm. who showed up and said, over there, and then realize halfway through, oh, that's wrong. And right. then you're just undoing it because the director said so. Reed and I found a nice little language, and everything was planned out, but you know, you get to the set, and the actors block it, and it's different. So you adjust, and you stay flexible. Mm-hmm. So part of the way we talk to each other, and I think I could find that language or that comfort with any DP, but with Reed it worked particularly well. Is it because we're women?
Well, we were also doubly blessed because Reed the shooter was going out with the gaffer, Matt.
Yes.
So everything was lit very beautifully.
Yes.
Or else. Well, it's funny because there's always a conversation in this town about not enough films made by women, not enough female writers. There was a piece out today about not enough female critics. And it seems that sometimes when it gets down to actually doing the work, that it's really not about that. It really is about just whatever the work was or is.
Well, I was spoiled, personally, mm-hmm. leaving the set, wanting to do a mostly female production again. It was just, because most of the productions I was on was just mostly, you know, the majority of men, like maybe two women. Mm-hmm. So, and we also had this wonderful producer, Heather Ray, who is Native American also. And she really put me at peace, too, all through the shoot. When it would get difficult, and having her there and having Courtney and, you know, just all the women on set was just, it was more comforting to me than I'd ever experienced with my work. So I came away very spoiled and wanting that again.
And did you feel any resistance to female writer or female director when you were trying to get the film made in the first place? Do you have any sense of that?
Well, no one will actually say that to you. I think it's the first time feature director
right.
That's the hurdle. And when I got on the set, I mean, I think it's like anything else. People aren't used to seeing a woman director. So there must be a moment where they go, gosh, I hope she knows what she's doing. You know, mm-hmm. from the crew or from the cast. But, you know, that's, again, just, it's a little hurdle. It takes about 3 days, I think, before your crew and your cast realize, okay, we're good. You know, and have confidence in you. But I think you earn that confidence regardless of your gender
mm-hmm.
and ethnicity. I think you just have to earn it. And it's so...
If you're confident, you earn it.
I think as people get more accustomed to the pattern of seeing women as directors, that it won't be such a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to say, just in my experience, it was about showing you could direct the picture and that you were in charge and you knew what to do next.
Mm.
So that the people that were working with you, you know, felt comfortable with that and could trust you.
It's definitely the biggest difference between what's the difference with men and women directors?
Right.
And the biggest actual difference is that it's much harder for the women to get everybody to listen to them. But mm-hmm. as she says, generally speaking, once you've gone on a few days and you're clearly competent, it really doesn't matter what your gender is.
What's interesting,
getting them to listen is that's the one you have to get over.
If you look at this movie, it's certainly indie and it's certainly small, but it also, in some ways, talking about female directors not getting the next opportunity, it seems like you're kind of set up to go direct a film, somebody else's film maybe, or somebody else's script of a thriller or something that has, you know, has the intimacy that you created here, but also has some degree of action and movement, because I think you showed you could do that with this.
Thank you, and that would be great.
Is that what you want to do? I mean, do you want to
do
Hollywood, or do you want to do more indies, or do
there's good stuff that comes out of Hollywood. Shoot, I'd love to do that. And I have another script that's like another soup to nuts process where I have to do the whole thing, and I'd love to walk in, take an assignment, direct. That would be a beautiful thing.
So have you seen a script that was this intimate, really, since then, since this movie? Have they come your way in other opportunities?
I'm writing my own, because there's not enough out there not enough opportunities that I would be given a chance to. So I gotta create my own. So that's what I'm up to right
now. So you're playing a Native American in it, or?
Well, I'm...
The nice lady next door was...
I'm a young woman, and it's a great story, it's really interesting, and I don't make a big deal of my ethnicity or my culture, but I'm Native American. I'm not, you know, I can't change that, but I'm also a person living today.
And Melissa, are you still seeing good stuff, or is it the mixed bag is always?
Really good scripts are hard to come by. More often you read something and it's got something for you in the role or something like that. I mean, really, when you get, I can really only think of a couple of occasions when I've actually really gotten a script that is as solid as Courtney's script clearly was. It's a rarity, it really is. But, you know, and then you go into it, you see who's working on it. I shot a film once a few years ago with a German director, Holger Ernst, that I couldn't read the damn script. I couldn't get past page 12. I didn't care about these kids. I met him and he was brilliant. And I had a wonderful time working with him. And he made an amazing film. Very true to his script.
Right.
Which part of it is. As you're beginning to watch the opening of the film, you sort of don't want to know these kids. But then, by the end of it, oh. So, you know, oftentimes, probably more often than it should be, the script is sort of a sort of idea of what you might do. But it's much better filmmaking when it's a really, really solid script, but it is kind of a rarity to really read something like that.
Well, it's hard because I think in some ways the commercial pressure that you felt trying to fund the movie is the same reason why people don't write the scripts. You know, there may be some writers who can do it, but they just need to blow something up, you know.
This process that Courtney did of really just doing her own story, all of that input, she's really good at sort of taking in people's notes and discarding what means nothing to her. And hanging on to that one good idea and seeing where she could work that into it, you know. I don't know where I was going with that.
So what's the experience been in the few months since Sundance? You've shown the movie, and you had a SAG screening the other night, and you got to show it to actors. And I mean, is it different each time? Is the experience of, did you watch the movie over, how many times have you guys actually watched the movie?
About
five.
Every
fifth or sixth screening, I take a peek at it. You know, I have some distance from it now, so it's quite moving. Whereas when you're cutting, you're just like, oh God, I can't look at this anymore. But once we got through that, it's the experience since Sundance has been like, first after Sundance, we just went home, we sold our movie, we went back to our little town, and waited for something to happen, and it was strange, like nothing. And now, you know, things as we come closer to the release date, there's a lot of publicity and all that stuff, which is a lot of fun to do. And audiences, you know, coast to coast are so interesting. And it's so interesting to hear what they say, what they get, what they don't get, when they're moved, you know, and they tell me that. That's huge. I mean, that's all.
Very often at the screenings, we come in, you know, last 5-10 minutes of the film and see that. And that's been a lovely experience, because you so often hear a comment, whatever the films are, the big films, the indie right. films, that it's unsatisfying, that they either tied it up in too tidy mm-hmm. of a bow, or there's all these loose ends, you don't know what happens. This film, when you walk in at the end of it, it is quite clear that this audience has done what you pay $12 to go to a movie theater and do.
Mm-hmm.
Go on an adventure and get to some satisfying end. And mm-hmm. that's the thing I feel that I'm delighted when I walk into the end of the film, is this sense of satisfaction that the audience clearly
Are you
has.
Seeing really distinct reactions, differences between the cities you're showing the movie on? Is there much variation, or are they all getting hit in the same place?
They're getting hit in the same place. And I'm surprised by that. Because I figured, the Sundance audience is this like precious audience, and of course they're rooting for you, and they're just a regular audience.
But they also want to kill you more than anybody else. Also, it's both you have it both ways.
I didn't have too much of that experience.
No.
So it was. I had a sort of a magical Sundance experience. But it's just nice to see the film affect people and to hear their questions and that little moment that you thought was lost did. Impact someone.
Mm-hmm.
And so, that's more than could possibly ever dream of. It's really amazing.
And it's one of the lovely things, I think, for that in the evolution of DVD and home entertainment, that people, even after a theatrical life of a picture like this, that people still find new things. And people watch these movies 6 times and 12 times and 15 times and whatever, and really kind of dip into it in a different way.
Yes. And now they're telling me things I didn't put in or see.
I've seen it maybe half a dozen times, and the last time I saw it, I saw something in it that I hadn't seen before, some quality aspect, whatever.
People are coming up and saying that it's an onion film, and that every time you see it, it peels off a new layer, and mm-hmm. It just keeps going.
Well, when you have a story that's so distinctive, and then you have characters that are so distinctive, and you have emotions that are. So intensely being driven through the picture,
mm-hmm.
I think that sometimes you have to catch your breath to figure out what happened, and that a second time or whatever you're catching it differently, and I guess people catch it in different ways.
Right.
We were just saying that about Batman, so I think it's true of almost any movie that has any quality at all. There's that there, but in this picture in particular, it's such a in some ways so beautifully unexpected. I don't think people go into the theater really understanding what they're getting themselves into, and then they're pleasantly surprised that they like movies,
right.
Which is kind of nice. Well, thank you all for coming out after all these months. We were going to do this at Sundance, and it never quite happened, but I'm glad we finally got around to it, and thanks.
Thank you.